In the Torah portion of Vayigash, we have this dramatic story of Joseph revealing himself to his brothers. He's the viceroy of Egypt. They never realized all along it was actually their long-lost brother who they almost tried to kill. Chapter 45, verse 3. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" Says Rabbi Elazar in the Babylonian Talmud, Tractate Chagiga, page 4b. When Rabbi Elazar came to this verse, he wept, exclaiming, "If the rebuke of a human being is so powerful, how much more so the rebuke of God?" The Tzemach Tzedek, Rabbi Menachem Mendel of Lubavitch, had the following question on this piece of Talmud. He said, "What's the comparison between the rebuke of man and the rebuke of God? Joseph's brothers harmed him. They hurt him. He was pained for decades. God is not hurt by us. If we sin, God forbid, we don't hurt God. He's perfect. There's nothing we can do to damage him. So what's the comparison between the rebuke of someone who is not hurt and the rebuke of someone who is pained?" Says the Tzemach Tzedek that we do, so to speak, harm God. Of course, his essence, the essence of God, is untouchable. But he has emanations. He has projections. The divine communicates with the lowly physical world through a whole chain of emanations, and that can get damaged, that can get hurt. And that's exactly what sin does, according to the Kabbalistic idea. We have vessels up there. They get damaged, they get cracked, they get pierced. And that interrupts and affects God's relationship with the world. So the comparison really is a fair one. And we should always remember that when we do goodness, we are healing and soothing that chain of emanation, enhancing our connection with God and His flow of His beneficence to the world. The Tzemach Tzedek also explained on chapter 46, verse 3, the descent to Egypt. Jacob was scared to go down there. It wasn't the greatest place to live. He liked this shepherd type of life where you're not involved with society. So why did he have to go down there? So history, according to the Kabbalah, is always connected to the broader idea of our purpose in life. And when it came to Jacob, who was this great leader of the Jewish people and of all humanity, he really had to go down to Egypt, says the Tzemach Tzedek, because he was looking for souls. There were certain souls there that had to be picked up, that had to be joined to the clan, that had to be part of that wholesome being of Jacob's souls, the Jewish people. And that is really the inner reason why he had to go there in search of souls. Chapter 46, verse 29. The verse tells us that Joseph appeared before Jacob, and the literal rendition of the verse is, "He revealed himself to him." Now that's an odd phrase. For a child to reveal himself to his father? What does that mean? I mean, he knew Joseph's identity by then. So the Kabbalists explain that there are two primordial sources of energy from which you could be derived, predominantly from one or predominantly from the other. One is the realm of Toihu, which means chaos. The other is the realm of Tikkun, which means healing. Each have their virtues. Generally speaking, we say that the realm of Tikkun is always the more virtuous. It's always the more holy, and it's always the more functional. Because Tikkun means fixed. It means healed. It means we've sorted out the problems. It means that we're not inclined to excessive behavior, to radical shifts in identity. We're not inclined to do crazy things and bring chaos to our lives. But Toihu, chaos, has one advantage that Tikkun does not. It has more passion. It has more energy. It's alive. And that was the advantage of chaos, of Toihu. Joseph came from the world of Tohu, whereas Jacob came from the world of Tikkun. And that is why Joseph revealed himself to Jacob. He actually possessed greater spiritual potential, greater energy. Toihu, the world of chaos, has that upper hand. And sometimes it is necessary and desirable to break out of our mold, to break out of concrete reality of order, and sometimes have that little bit of extra spark of energy from the world of Tohu. Chapter 46, verse 30, we read how Jacob is has this exchange with Joseph. Israel, that's Jacob, said to Joseph, "If I would die this time, I would be comforted, since I have seen your face, that you are still alive." Now, was it so important to Jacob to see Joseph's face? I mean, he'd heard he was alive from reliable sources. Why did he actually have to see him? So, one of the explanations is that hearing someone's alive, you only hear about their physical life. He wanted to see Joseph, because only then could he really tell if Joseph had kept his spiritual values, his ethical values, his moral values. Whether he was spiritual life, Jacob could sense that from his presence, but not from a distant testimony. And that is really what he was saying. "Now I've seen you alive. I see that there's spiritual transmission. I have a successor. The message of Judaism, the message of true monotheism is going to be perpetuated in the world. Now I'm a happy man." And the lesson for us is obvious. That's what we want to see in our children. We want to see that transmission. Chapter 47, verse 9, we have a meeting between Jacob and Pharaoh. Jacob says to Pharaoh, "I've been wandering around for 130 years. Compared to my father's lifetimes, when they were wandering around, the days of my life have been few and miserable." Since you've been watching this podcast for the last few weeks, I'm sure you have picked up a lot of Kabbalistic ideas, and the number 130 will for sure ring a bell. That was the number of years which Adam separated from his wife after the tragic murder of Abel by Cain, and we are told that in that time he fathered these spirits, these unhealthy, dysfunctional souls. And Adam was reincarnated multiple times, especially in the patriarchs Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to correct all the mistakes which occurred. And Jacob finally is reaching the end of his life. He hints to this. 130 years I've been walking around miserable. I had to have 130 miserable years to achieve tikkun, to achieve spiritual healing for that mistake of Adam, of whose soul I am reincarnated. And now he says, finally, he's going to have 17 good years, post-tikkun years, after this healing has been done. That's why they were good years, because he'd achieved his purpose in life, and now he's already tasting the benefits and reaping the rewards. Spiritual message for the week. We begin this Torah portion of Vayigash with Judah thinking that his brother Joseph is the horrible viceroy of Egypt, who is not very sympathetic to him, but one of the most powerful men in the world. Judah approaches Joseph and he starts shouting at him and screaming at him in defense of his brother. Now, I love that story because it's all about the visceral response rather than the rational response. The rational response is often very effective, but it can lack a certain conviction. We're too detached, we're too speculative, we're wondering what might be right and what might be wrong. Judah wasn't sitting speculating about why what happened. You don't shout at one of the most powerful men in the world and break all sort of protocol. But it came from the gut. He just felt, I have to stick up for my brother. There was just no other way about it. It was instinctual. It was visceral. And I think that's a powerful message to us, that our Judaism shouldn't just be some sort of speculation that we think about. It needs to penetrate very deep, that we're willing to defend our Jewish values and proudly display our Jewishness at a very visceral level. Think about that, and please join us next week for Torah in 10.